Be with you.
We
welcome you to our Redeemer Lutheran Church with School. I'd like to take time to greet the rest of you, but it's already time to worship. So we turn it over to our Joyful Sounds music team as once again they lead us in songs of praise and thanksgiving to our Savior Jesus.
Please rise and sing with us.
Our God has done great things. He got you all here. God's be praised. Thank you for joining us in worship. I guess we should say, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. This is like an Easter time attendance. Nice to have you all back. It's the mix and mingle. I know it. In remembrance of our baptism, we make the sign of the Holy Cross as we invoke God to be present in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord is my portion. I promise to keep your words. I entreat your favor with all my heart. Be gracious to me according to your promise. When I think of my ways, I turn my feet to your testimonies. I hasten and do not delay to keep your commandments. I am a companion of all who fear you, of those who keep your precepts. The earth, O Lord, is full of your steadfast love. Teach me your statutes. Let us now confess our sin to God, our merciful Father. Gracious God, we admit and confess our sinfulness. We are by nature sinful and unclean. Daily we do things we ought not do, and do not live up to your calling as the people of your pasture and the sheep of your hand. We justly deserve your punishment in this life and for eternity. Trusting in your mercy, we come to you for forgiveness. Our trust is in the merits of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Have mercy on us, O God. Grant us remission of all our sins and lead us to renewed lives that reflect your goodness and love. God is gracious and merciful. He hears our supplications and joyfully restores us to his fold. By the command of our Lord and as his called and ordained servant, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, our good shepherd, grant that we, with all boldness and courage, bring to you our petitions, with the assurance that you care for us as individuals. With your abiding care, grant us every good thing for this life and every blessing in the life to come. For you live with and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is from Ezekiel. For thus says the Lord God, behold, I myself will search for my sheep, and I will seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock when he is among his sheep that have been scattered, so will I seek out my sheep, and I will rescue them all from places where they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. And I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the ravines, and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them with good pasture, and on the mountain heights of Israel shall be their grazing land. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and on a rich pasture they will feed on the mountains of Israel. And I will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I myself will make them lie down, declares the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak, and the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them in justice. As for you, my flock, thus says the Lord God, behold, I judge between sheep and sheep, between rams and male goats. Is it not enough for you to feed on the good pasture, that you must tread down with your feet the rest of your pasture and drink of clear water? That you must muddy the rest of the water with your feet? And must my sheep eat what you have trodden with your feet and drink with what you have muddied with your feet? Therefore, thus says the Lord God to them, behold, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you push with side and shoulder and thrust at all the weak with your horns, till you have scattered them abroad. I will rescue my flock, and they shall no longer be prey. And I will judge between sheep and sheep, and I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David. And he shall feed them, and he shall feed them and be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God. And my servant David shall be prince among them. I am the Lord, I have spoken. Thanks. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from 1 Timothy. I thank him who has given me strength, Christ Jesus our Lord, because he judged me faithful, appointing me to his service. Though formerly I was a blasphemer, persecutor, and insolent opponent, but I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the love and the faith that are in Christ Jesus. This saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance. With Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But I received mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience as an example to those who were to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 15th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. I want you to do a little interaction with me. When you hear the phrase, and it's used two times in the Gospel lesson, rejoice with me, I want you to say, yippee, hooray. All right, let's try it one time. Rejoice with me, yippee, hooray. Well done. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to Jesus, and the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. So he told them this parable. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, yippee, hooray, for I have found my sheep that was lost. Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, rejoice with me, yippee, hooray, for I have found the coin that I had lost. So I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. It's time for our children's sermon, and I know we've got some children here today, so please come and join me up in the narthex, up in the chancel. Yeah, good to see you all. And I'm assuming, and I know this is a great assumption on the pastor's part, but we have so many children here because we're back in our school year. Isn't it great to be back at school? Yippee, hooray! And that was just from our staff. Yippee, hooray! So good to see you, all of you. All right, quick question for you. What does a car, an automobile, a car, and an elephant have in common?
They're both very heavy.
They're both very heavy. Yes, they are.
They're both very big.
They're both very big. Yeah. Help me out. They both have trunks. Oh, I'm pausing for great hilarity to happen, and it's not happening. Yeah. Trunk, you know, you get it, your trunk, and then the trunk in the back where you put your luggage. Okay, yeah. All right. What else do they have in common? You ready for this? They both have a radiator. Whoa, what does that mean? Do you know what a car radiator looks like? Have you ever seen a car radiator? Where in the car is a radiator? Unless you're driving an electric car. Where in the car is it a radiator? Is it in the back or the front? It's in the front, yeah. And it's usually right behind that grill work. Maybe there's some chrome or some honeycomb-looking stuff, slats in the front. And right behind that is a radiator. And the radiator has water in it. It has water in it and a little fan on it. And you have to have that in a car because you have to have this cool water
antifreeze, but don't worry about it. If cool water, go through the entire motor to keep it cool. Otherwise, it'll overheat. And I know you never want to be in a car that over... Any of you ever been in a car that is overheated? Look at all those hands. Yeah. Oh, it's a pain in the old trunk. Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, a car has to have a radiator in it to keep it cool. Now, where do you suppose an elephant has a radiator? Oh, pretty close, behind the trunk, behind its ears. Have you ever seen a picture of an elephant? Of course you have. They have huge ears. Some ears as big as I am. I'm almost 6 feet. Some elephant ears are bigger than 6 feet. Big old flapping ears. And you know what? They've got little tiny veins on those back of the ears. Do you have veins? Where are your veins? Can you show me? Yeah, in your hands you can see veins. If you can't see them in your hands, when you go and visit Grandma and Grandpa, ask to see their hands. It's nice to have you back. It's great to have you back. We've been lonely without you. The elephant has veins behind its ears, and even real small veins, tiny little veins, starts with a C, capillaries. They have tons of these little small veins called capillaries behind their ears, and that's why if you ever watch an elephant, they'll be flapping their ears a lot to keep cool. It's just like their radiator. That keeps their whole body cool. And sometimes they'll even suck up water in their trunk. Have you ever seen them do that on a YouTube visit? Maybe you take a look at that today, this afternoon. Get your parents off their social media and tell them you want to see an elephant cool himself off with some water. Yeah, you tell them that, all right? Tell them the pastor said that. Yeah. And they take their trunk, they suck up water, and then they go... They splash it behind their ears and then fan themselves just to stay cool. All right. Why are we talking about all this stuff? Because coming to church makes us cool. No, we have to stay cool. Sometimes it gets very hot out. What do you do to stay cool when it's hot out? Go inside if you have air conditioning? Yeah. What else might you do to stay cool? Maybe... Go underneath a tree. Get under some shade. Very good. Very good. Maybe some of you will drink some water, huh, to stay cool? Yeah, to cool off. Well, just like trying to stay cool for an elephant, a car, and us at times, we need to come to church to stay cool. And we also need that help to stay cool. And that help comes to us by coming to church, by going to Sunday school, by reading God's Word, by praying. And so let's have a little prayer. Dear God, help us stay cool by coming to church, going to Sunday school, and right now in this prayer. Amen. Thanks, boys and girls. Yippee, hooray!
Mercy and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We're excited about the new school year, aren't we? Yes, we are, and all of you parents are assuredly excited. And our theme for the school year, as we pointed out in our sermon, if you were with us last week, our last slide was this: making disciples for life. And it's based on this passage from Matthew 28. It's the very last words of our disciples, of our Lord to his disciples. And I always have to stand on a pew to do this, because Jesus was being ascended into heaven. He's taken off. And his very last words to his followers: all authority on earth has been given, in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And then he gives them a beautiful promise: surely I will be with you always, to the very end of the age. Now that, my friends, is known as the Great Commission. That's the official moniker of it. But we also know it as the marching order of the church. This is what we are to do. It is the reason for our existence. It is the very purpose for the ministry of our Redeemer Lutheran Church with school: to go, baptize, and teach. We can't do any more than this. It is our soulful commitment. Go, engage, make contact, baptize, and teach. Who does God love? Who does God love? The world. Those first six words of John 3:16. By the way, I've got my Great Commission socks on. John 3:16. They're holy. Actually, they're not. It's only like the second time I've ever worn them. But anyway, John, the first six words of John 3:16, for God so loved the world, everyone in the world. God sends us out into the world. Jesus left this world, but he commissioned each and every one of us as his believers to follow him and continue to share it. And what kind of love is that love for the world? It is unconditional. It knows no boundaries. It's sacrificial. It's all-giving. It's unadulterated. It's pure. It's complete. I lost all my adverbs or adjectives. I'm done with it. It's beautiful. An unconditional love for the world. When Jesus wanted to make an important point with his disciples, he often told a story or two. He calls them parables. In Luke 15, this chapter that we read as our gospel lesson, we read two of those stories, and the third story is there as well. The first one is the lost sheep. How many sheep were there? 100, and one got lost. And, of course, the shepherd seeks diligently to find that one sheep. And when he finds it, he says, come, rejoice with me. Yippee. Be hooray. What was that, short-term memory? Rejoice with me. Yippee, hooray. And I take note of this.
We've got back-to-back parables, and I love to see this because it's about finding something lost. So first he goes after the man. He says, a man loses his sheep. And now he says, a woman. That's comforting for me to know that women can lose things. I thought it was only men who got lost. Never stopped to ask for directions. You know what I mean? So anyway, but one of the few times in Scripture that Jesus tells back-to-back parables, and he doesn't show partiality to gender. It's both men and women. All right, so a woman, what does she have? She has 10 silver coins, and she loses one, and what does she do? She lights a lamp, she sweeps the house, and seeks diligently until she finds it, and then she tells her friends and neighbors, rejoice with me, yippee, hooray, for I have found that which was lost. Now, the third parable is the lost son. You may know it, those of you who are involved in Bible study, better as it's normal, a different title, the what kind of son? Prodigal son. You remember the story very well, don't you? Young man, the younger son, seeks his inheritance early, before the dad dies. Hey, Dad, I know you got your will set aside for me. I'm going to get a third of the action. I want it now, before you even die. And of course, he squanders it away on extravagant living. And he ends up feeding pigs. And, you know, the worst thing you could do as a Jew is to feed pigs. It's an unclean animal. And he's so hungry, he's eating the pods that he's feeding the pig. Ah, terrible sin. Comes back and he repents, before God and before you, I repent, I'm sorry. And the father, who's represented by this old man, and we don't want to make God old, but it's a metaphor for Almighty God himself. The Father wraps him in his loving arms, runs to meet him, gives him the signet ring, oh, and has a feast, the fatted calf, the whole shot. And of course, the older brother, Dad, I've been here the whole time. You never did anything for me like this. And the father says, oh, but we have to rejoice. Come and rejoice with me. Yippee, hooray, for your brother who was lost has now been found. Yeah, what a wonderful scene. God loves unconditionally. This man receives sinners and eats with them. Jesus tells us to love one another as I have loved you. Unconditionally. Now, the religious leaders of the day, the Pharisees and the scribes, they see all these people who are coming to hear Jesus speak. And what do they say? Can you read that with me? This man receives sinners and eats with them. Did you note the word? They grumbled about this. They grumbled. That would be like some outside neighbors around our church watching all of you come to church. I'm putting this together for you. You'll see it. They're pointing to, look at all those hypocrites going to church. Yeah, they're sinners. They're just no better than me. Yeah, grumble. We do the same. We who are in church, we who are the righteous, we who have been saved, we who believe, we point to those people and we marginalize them out there. We don't want them in here. We don't want that kind here. They're different than we are. Thank God they are, but not in God's eyes. Remember, he loves unconditionally. No boundaries. He loves the world. He loves each and every one of us. Life lesson, I can remember this. Obviously, I can remember it because I'm telling it. My father was a pastor, as many of you know. Very busy man. I know you think we only work one day a week. And at that, you know, a half day in the morning on Sunday, you know, that's it. That's it. But he wasn't around very much. But when he was around, he always tried to make it up. And I could remember this. I could remember where I was standing in the front yard at the parsonage. And he said to me, you know, Bobby, he says, let's go out miniature golfing. He says, why don't you call all your friends, you know, and let's go out miniature golfing. And, you know, and he, Les and Bobby and Jack, and, you know, and he went on the list. And I said, yeah, but, you know, I don't want that guy to come. And my dad looked at me kind of strangely, and I said, I really don't like him. I can remember this. Life lesson for all you kids. You may not like everyone, but my dad said, you have to love them. You have to love them. You guys have made that extremely easy here. Because I like all of you. And I am blessed to love you as well. With that same love that God has extended to me. And that's the type of love we are to share with one another. Go. Love one another as I have loved you, with that unconditional love. No judgment, no criticism, no boundaries. It doesn't matter if they're not like you. It doesn't matter if you like them or not. You have to love them. So go. Make an intentional interaction with them. You know, no one's going to walk into this church by accident. They're not going to come by and see a bunch of cars over in the lot and go, you know what, I think I'm going to stop in there and see what's going on. They have to be invited. And God is telling you to do the inviting. Most of you know, or some of you know at least, I live out off of 11 in Autumn. And they're doing the water tower. Have you seen that? That project has been going on for over a month and a half now. I hope it's not T&L. I hope it's not time and labor. Man, it's forever. And we've got our watchdogs, the Selgren family. They're there with their binoculars. Gloria and Ralph, they're making sure that it's being done right. They're watching that every day. Guys going up and down, kind of like a ride at an amusement park, you know, up and down on the cables and stuff, spraying and wiping and scrambling. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's going on and on. Anyway, that whole area, if you've ever gone down 11, it keeps on populating with houses. Boom, 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 boom. There's like four or five of them going up right now. The other day, Susie and I were walking. Nice young man, we commented, hey, great looking house, and it was nighttime and he is watering the lawn. Yeah, grass is even coming up now. And we engaged. And Susie, this is Susie's idea. She says, you know, we ought to put together like door hangers. We'll put a cookbook in it. A little door hanger. And I bet you're living around some people as well. Moving in. You know the old welcome wagon? Why can't we, as members of the church, go over there and just introduce ourselves? And that's what we did. We ended up talking to man. By the way, are we still playing basketball on Thursdays? Are they going to start that up anymore? Anybody? If you find out, kind of a tall, lanky fellow, and he says, I see you guys got a pretty big gymnasium down there. And I said, yeah, full-size court. He goes, you can play some ball? I'm looking for a group to play with. And I said, I'll try to find out for you. Nice guy. Happens to be a member of a church, but that doesn't bother us. We're happy to have him come and participate. Go, go, make an intentional interaction with them. Baptize. We had three baptisms last week. We got one right after this. Eloise, Jane will be baptized into the kingdom. We've got four scheduled next month, early next month. God be praised. Rejoice with me. Yippee, hooray. It's like the pastor who made the announcement during the prayer, and he says, yes, we're so pleased to enter into the kingdom. We're baptizing Joseph today. And a little four-year-old stood up on his pew and raised his fist. Yay, God! Yay, Joe! Yay, Joe! And the congregation reacted like you used to 25 years ago. You know, sitting on your hands and, you know, and looking down. And, well, how do we react? You know, what do we do in church? We can't yell or anything, can't we? We can't clap. We certainly can't. We can't have contemporary music in the chancel. Oh, my goodness gracious. Don't anyone dance, even though it's in the Bible. Anyway, yay, Joe. And the mom pulled him down and said, we don't do that in church. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, we do. I think we've missed out on something when we don't celebrate these special things. Yay, Joe. Yay, Eloise. That's what we're going to say. Rejoice with me. Yippee, hooray. Celebrate all the things that are going on. The mission in our church, at our Redeemer Lutheran Church with School. Yippee, hooray. Amen. and may the peace of God that surpasses all of our understanding keep our hearts and minds in him unto life everlasting. Amen. And I ask you to do just that with me as we celebrate the installation. Excuse me, I guess we'll do the Apostles' Creed first. Our statement of faith: I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now we have the instrument. You may be seated, but I'd like to have the staff come forward. As we install our Christian Day School teachers, I need the four of you front and center, maybe right here someplace. Mr. Jeffrey Holt, Miss Deb Holt, Mrs. Deb Holt, Mindy Firm, and Ken Ann Clam. Middle school pre-K interim principal. Beloved in the Lord, these four people have been elected and called as teachers at our Redeemer Lutheran Church with School. This office has been established by the love of the church to support the office of public ministry and to assist and strengthen Christian fathers and mothers as they are given that God-given responsibility to bring up their children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Hear what the Lord says about this. And Jesus called them, and he said, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called into one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thanksgiving in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." I ask you, do you believe and confess the canonical books of the Old and New Testament to be the inspired word of God and the only infallible rule of faith and practice? So answer, yes, I believe. Do you believe and confess the three ecumenical creeds? Can you help me out? What are they? We just said one of them, the Apostles, the Nicene, and the big long one, Athanasian, to be the faithful testimonies in the truth of the Holy Scriptures and to reject all the errors which they condemn? So answer, yes, I believe and confess.
Yes, I believe and confess.
Do you confess the unaltered Augsburg Confession to be the true exposition of Holy Scripture and a true exhibition of the doctrine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church? And then it lists all these things that are in the Book of Concord, yada, 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 yada. Anyway, say, yes, I make these confessions my own.
Yes, I make these confessions my own.
Do you solemnly promise faithfully to serve God's people in the teaching ministry in accordance with the Holy Scripture and with these confessions? Yes, I so promise with the help of God. Will you, trusting in God's care, seek to grow in love for those you serve, strive for excellence in your skills, and adorn the gospel of Jesus Christ with a godly life? I so answer, I will with the help of God.
I will with the help of God.
You, the members of our Redeemer, I address you. You've heard their confession and their solemn promise. I ask you, as they have been called to teach in our church, I ask you now, in the presence of God, will you receive them and show them fitting love and honor and support them by your gifts and fervent prayer? If so, answer, we will with the help of God. So you've already got their backing. So the Almighty and most merciful God strengthen and assist you always.
Are you ready to assume this work entrusted to you by our Lord and Savior Jesus? So answer, I am. Then, Ken, Mindy, Deb, Jeff, I install you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit as teachers at our Redeemer Lutheran Church with school. Amen. Rejoice with me. Yippee, hooray. And if I may ask you to kneel. And in order to know that you're not at this alone, I ask that your fellow staff, co-workers, give this solemn pledge.
We thank God that
we are privileged by His grace and mercy to share in the ministry of His Word at our Redeemer. With you, we share the joys and trials, the responsibilities and rewards of building the Savior's kingdom. We pledge you our support and understanding, our love and prayers. We today, with you, rededicate ourselves, our time, talents, and treasures to the end that God's name may be hallowed, that His kingdom may come, and that His will may be done. Can I hear an amen? Amen. And we pray. Gracious and merciful Father, we thank you for providing faithful men and women in your church to assist and support the ministry. You told us to go, make disciples of all nations, and particularly teaching them to obey everything you have commanded us. Lord, grant your Holy Spirit's wisdom and power upon those kneeling before your throne, asking for your blessing of godliness and obedience as they share your love with the children of our church school. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace and joy. The Almighty and most merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you, bless you, and strengthen you for faithful service in His name. Amen. Thank you. Rejoice with me. Yippee, hooray! We welcome our newest staff members. Okay, thank you. And the blessing that our Redeemer has had for 108 years, a Sunday school program. I ask Sunday school teachers to please join us. Sunday school, Kingdom Kids leaders, FBI, youth counselors, all who are participating in our program. Even if you're a snack person, I'm not going to get your mother-in-law up here, am I? And Kim Shanky. Beloved in the Lord, these people, I address, beloved in the Lord, these people have been properly volunteered with not much arm twisting at all, Lord, and they are ready to assume the awesome duty of continuing the education of the children through our Sunday school programs and youth ministry. This office has been established by your love in support of the holy ministry of our church. We ask that you allow them to help strengthen the Christian fathers and mothers for their God-given responsibility, as we heard for our Christian day school teachers, in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Now hear the word concerning this. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for it is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you, and that you may enjoy long life on earth. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. And that's what we are to do in assisting our families in doing that. Brothers and sisters in Christ, we ask, do you solemnly pledge and promise to faithfully carry out and serve God's people in the teaching in our Christian days, in our Sunday school and youth group program and ministry, the Holy Scripture, Answer, yes, with the help of God. Yes, with the help of God. Will you, trusting in God's care, seek to grow in love for those you serve, strive for the excellence in your gifts and skills, and adorn the gospel with the holy life? So answer, I do so promise. Brothers and sisters, I install you as teachers in our Sunday school and youth ministry. I do so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And go with the blessing. The Almighty God, the Maker of all, who gives us His love, may He share your spirit, His spirit, with you, so that you may share His love in the teaching of the children of our congregation. We ask this in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Yippee, hooray! Yippee, hooray! All right. Thank you, thank you, thank you. As I mentioned, over a century we've been teaching Sunday school at our church, and we thank these people for continuing that process. Those who are ill, Barb Mailing, those of you who have been following us, she had a portion of her lung removed and she's recovering well at this point. Wayne Rohde also is taking baby steps. He hopes to be back from Texas. He's been down there for close to a month now. By the end of the month, he hopes to be back. And Sue Thielen, again, the mother of the Sarah Dusterbeck of our congregation, continues with her cancer treatments. We also remember our pastoral call committee. We remember the homegoing a week ago of Nancy Kramer. That's the mother of Kirsten Kramer, Miss Kramer of our congregation. Her funeral service was last Sunday afternoon, and just this past week she was laid to rest. We ask your blessing upon those who are serving as troops and first responders, law enforcement, healthcare workers. We pray for the installation of our many teachers. We also rejoice at a baptism. We mentioned Eloise Jane Rasmussen, who will be brought into the kingdom shortly after this worship service. Yippee, hooray!
Yippee, hooray! Yeah.
And birthdays. Pastor Bill Wagner will be celebrating his, I point to Kendra, his daughter, will be celebrating his 82nd birthday on Wednesday. And Mildred Bonus will be celebrating her 92nd
birthday on Saturday. With that, I ask you to please rise. Lord, once again, we ask your healing hand of grace to be upon those who are in need. We ask your blessing upon those who have injuries, those who have diseases, those who are recovering from problems. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we thank you for calling home your servant Nancy. You've restored her into that perfect image of God. She now wears that crown of everlasting righteousness. In great peace and joy, she surrounds your throne with all the saints, and we yell, yippee, hooray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our next pastor. You already have decided who that's going to be. Now we just have to discern by the power of your Holy Spirit whom you would like us to choose. So, Lord, bless our call committee as they continue this process. Lord, in your mercy, we thank you for all those people whom you've called to serve us. We think of our Christian day school teachers, our Sunday school teachers, our youth directors, all those people whom you've placed to help parents train up and teach children in a nurture and admonition of the Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer, as well as troops and law enforcement and first responders and health care workers. Give them the courage and the strength to do what they have been called to do. Lord, in your mercy. And we let out again a yippee hooray for Eloise Jane, as you will receive her into the kingdom through the washing of holy baptism. Lord, in your mercy. And we thank you for another year of grace that you've bestowed upon your servant, Pastor Wagner, as well as Millie Bonas. Lord, continually watch them, watch over them, protect them, and grant them health. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has also taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Go then with the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. Amen.
What can I do with this fire on the inside? I'm burning up with this truth I can't hide. You're the reason for this hope in my life. Gonna let it shine. I have to let it shine. This is what we live for. To go where you say go. To let the whole world know. You're the light in the darkness. Oh, this is what we live for. To love the way you love. So God be lifted up. I have to testify. This is what we live for. To go where you say go. To let the whole world know. You're the light in the darkness. Whoa, this
Rejoice with me. Yippee, hooray! All right, and we want you to rejoice with one another, especially our teachers. And I ask our Christian day school teachers and our Sunday school teachers, go on, get out of here. Get out of here. Go in the fellowship hall and please greet them and thank them for their service and for their willing dedication. You guys can be seated, by the way. But please, teachers and Sunday school teachers, get out of here. We've got our mix and match going on here, our mix and mingle going on. If there happens a result in a match, that's a good thing too. Yippee, hooray! But anyway, our mix and mingle, please join us. We want to greet you, all of you people who are here. Choir is starting up on September the 21st. Come and sing and eat pie as well. We're going to have dessert for you. Pie after the singing. Even if you can't sing very well, come and eat pie with us. So please, on September the 21st at 6 p.m., and as we've mentioned a number of times, we rejoice with the Rasmussen family as we will bring in Eloise Jane into the kingdom through the washing of holy baptism. I think that's it. Yay, Joel!